This brings us to the definition of constraint propagation. Constraint propagation is a method of inference that assigns values to variables characterizing a problem in such a way that some conditions are satisfied. So if you have any problem, that problem is going to be characterized by some variables, and the task is to give specific values to each variable in such a way that some global constraints are being satisfied. So given a problem, so problems are characterized by a set of variables. Each variable may locally take on some value. However, the question is, how can we locally assign values to variables in such a way that some global constraints are satisfied? As an example, let us return to this figure. Here is a figure drawn on a 2D surface, and the problem is whether or not it represents a 3D object. The variables here are the surfaces and the orientations. One could consider this to be a single two-dimensional surface with some lines drawn on it. Alternatively, one can think of this as having four surfaces, 1, 2, 3, 4, where each surface has a particular orientation. The orientation can be specified by the perpendicular to that surface. The method of constraint propagation is going to help identify the surfaces and their orientations. The constraints here are defined by these junctions. For trihedral objects, where three surfaces meet at a particular point, these junctions have certain properties. No matter how we assign the surfaces and the orientations, the assignment must satisfy all of those constraints. We'll look at the details of constraint propagation in a minute. But first, notice that there are two possible interpretations to this particular 3D object. One can look at it as if one were looking inside a box. Alternatively, one can look at it as if one were looking at a building. This means that constraint propagation need not necessarily always succeed in disambiguating between different kind of assignments of surfaces and the orientations. Sometimes multiple interpretations can simultaneously satisfy all the constraints. It is also possible that no assignment of values to the variables will satisfy all the constraints, in which case the interpretation becomes very difficult. As another example, let us examine this sentence, "Colorless green ideas sleep furiously." All of us can recognize that this is semantically meaningless, but grammatically correct. How did we know that this is grammatically correct? The variables here are the various lexical categories, like verbs and nouns and subjects and predicates. The values are the assignments we make to these various words here. Is green a noun? Is green a verb? Is green a determiner? Is it part of a subject or part of a predicate? The constraints here are defined by the rules of English language grammar. As we assign values to the various variables here, that assignment must satisfy the constraints of the English language grammar, so that as we assign values to these variables, those assignments must satisfy the constraints on the English language grammar before we can accept this sentence to be grammatically correct. If this sentence was grammatically not correct, then we will not be able to assign values to all the variables in a way that will satisfy the constraints imposed by the English language grammar.
So we've actually come across this idea of constraints in English language grammar before. During our lesson on understanding, we talked about how a preposition, for example, can constrain the meaning of the word that follows it. If we see the word from, for example, we expect what comes after it to be some kind of source for the sentence. There, we used grammatical constraints in service of some kind of semantic analysis. Here, we're just using grammatical constraints to figure out if a sentence is grammatically correct or not. There's another connection here to understanding as well. Ashok talked about how we can interpret this shape as either popping out towards us or down into the screen. We talked about two simultaneously accurate interpretations of the same thing in understanding, with regard to sentences that can be read as puns. So for example, when I said, "It's hard to explain puns to kleptomaniacs because they always take things literally," the word "take" can simultaneously be interpreted as interpret and physically remove, while satisfying all the constraints of the sentence.